Getting the Carolina vinegar sauce, Piedmont style, ready.
Just put the butts on about 30 minutes ago. 4 9-pound Boston butt cuts at your shoulder, going on for my nephew Oliver's graduation. And then later, got 24 racks of ribs. I got 9 in there, and I got the rest of them all in there. Cook those tomorrow. Ribs don't take that long, but I gotta get up, pull the membrane off the back, rub them up a little bit, and then get them on the cooker. A wood box right here. Got some oak and hickory in there. Here's my oak. Here's some hickory. Not there. And that goes in there, and that smoke comes in, and it just goes over the top of the pork and around it, and then it exits this way. Now, I'm not sure everybody's seen my barbecue cooker made by Harley down in Lucia, North Carolina, but it is a mixture of gas so that I can regulate my heat. Say what you want. I'm a one-man op, and I got to do, well, 4 butts is nothing, but I'm going to cook these till about midnight, and then tomorrow put on 24 racks of ribs and get those cooked. So when you're doing a big cook and you're by yourself, having the ease and the regularity of that gas and being able to add my wood right there into the wood box and get the smoke flavor, that is the best of both worlds. I'm real happy with it because I am the lord of lollygag, and I want to work as little as possible and still get the job done. Yep, barbecue central. Some North Carolina style, Piedmont style Boston butts cooking up today. Making homemade ice cream too, a buttermilk ice cream with peppermint chocolate mint Milano cookies. Here we go. I have the ice cream mixed up. Start adding my ice. I add some rock salt, some Morton's ice cream salt. That goes on the outside. I think a lot of people think you put the rock salt on the inside. Yep, it's the old Proctor. Gotta keep coming and checking and adding ice, a little bit of rock salt, plenty of ice, and then it'll seize up and then the ice cream is done. But I'll stop it and I'll be adding those.
Ooh, Pepperidge Farm meets Chocolate Milano.
Yeah. Benucci. We take the Pepperidge Farm Mint Milano.
Yeller.
Carl, what are you fixing to do to those Pepperidge Farm Mint Milano cookies?
Yeller. I reckon I'm getting ready to take this rolling pin and pound them. Somebody might want to call an ice cream maker.
So what I do here is just kind of give them a little crush. Break them up, and then I'm gonna dump that into the ice cream pretty soon. But first I gotta let that ice cream just kind of thicken up a little bit so it doesn't make the cookies all soggy and then just turn into goo. Now when you start getting this icy frost on the outside of your ice cream maker, you're getting to doing some good, your ice is right. Lid it back on. All right, then we just get it going again. It's seized up. Now, man, that's hard. So now what I'll do, pour this water off, repack it, and let it sit. Start packing this thing in ice and get some rock salt in there. Got my lid on with my little hole covered here. I use that little green thing. Keep any rock salt ice bits out of the ice cream. I'm gonna pack it like this. And we'll add a little bit more rock salt. And then I like to put a plastic bag over it. Get a little vapor barrier. And boom, let it sit. Why, Shug? Why not just put it in the freezer? Well, let me tell you, I have done that many a time, and it is okay to do. But I'm gonna tell you this. Sitting in that ice and rock salt right down now, it tempers better. It doesn't freeze hard like it would in the freezer. It's a different freeze. A little bit of smoke, oak, a chunk of hickory. It is time for cutting the cabbage. Hey, we'll make a short work of this, chop it up into bits, put it in the Cuisinart. Oh yes, sir. Time to flip the butts. Now, putting the fat side down. I cook it for several hours with the fat side up, so that fat can just run through. Man, there's even a little bit of meat stuck right there. Mm. Goodness gracious. What I will do is hit that with a little bit of Piedmont style Carolina vinegar sauce. Oh, I wish you could smell that vinegar hitting that pork. So what I like to do is, I clean the outside leaves off my cabbage, all right? And then I chop it up into manageable sizes and start hitting pulse chop. That's probably about the chop I want right there. That is about the chop I'm looking for. That'll cling to the buns like it's clinging to my fingers right now. Now this is my sauce to make a red slaw that I'm going to add into that cabbage. That's about a cup of ketchup, about a half a cup of cider vinegar, about a half a cup of sugar, about 2 teaspoons of pepper, teaspoon of salt, and several dashes of your favorite hot sauce. All right, now start mixing up this red slaw just by adding a little bit of this at a time. And I'll take a spoon, and I just start. And I'll keep mixing this until I get it to where I like it. Just keep rolling that cabbage and that sauce together. Now your red slaw, it's finely chopped, it's peppery, it's not hot, it's a bit vinegary but not overwhelming, and it's on the sweet side a little bit. Now, I got me a couple of containers here. This is probably about 6 cups maybe. If you haven't seen one of my barbecue videos or you don't know anything about North Carolina, Piedmont style chopped pork barbecue sandwich. Where I'm from in the Piedmont is central North Carolina. So I grew up in Charlotte, which is in the southern central of the Piedmont. And a lot of barbecue places there more often than not serve a red slaw. The red slaw has no mayonnaise in it. Well, it's called a squeaky slaw. But when my dad would take me out for a barbecue sandwich, we'd always go to a place with red slaw. So to me, it's just memories of me and my dad, and me and my mom, and me and my whole family going out for barbecue. And our family, the Emrys, we got excited about red slaw. Now, different people feel a different way because barbecue's that way. All right, man, I just uncovered this ice cream, and it has got the perfect consistency right now. I mean, Ow! Serenading the meat a little bit. Now I always think meat, any food you cook, tastes a little bit better, actually tastes a lot better if you spend time with it. You know, barbecue is a labor-intensive process, but sit out and just pay attention to your meat. Sing it a song, talk to it, hang out by it, just dedicate your time to it. I think it definitely makes for the sweet meat. So when I'm talking about pork, I don't make it professionally, but for these graduation parties, I get them every year, and you know, they're family members. So you always got to count for about 100 people. That's just the general thing. Sometimes you get a little bit more, sometimes you get a little bit less, but with barbecue, it's nice to have some leftovers. And when people are leaving late at night, you can give them a pork pack to go. Hey, get your pork pack here. You give them some buns, you give them some pork. You know, you make that sandwich. I like a sandwich made up with the meat, the bun, the slaw on top. Wrapped in a piece of wax paper, man, let it sit overnight in the fridge, eat it cold the next day. Amen! So when I was a boy, my dad worked for a company called McClure Lumber Company, which was in Charlotte, North Carolina. And this is a few years after he got out of the Navy. He was a chief in the Navy for like 25 years, maybe 26. And there were some friends we met in a neighborhood called Coolwood Hills, which is outside on the west side of Charlotte, North Carolina. Anyway, the barbecue story is, the lumber company had a lake house, and mainly it belonged to some of the big wigs, but, you know, we'd all get to go up there from time to time, and they'd have a barbecue every summer. And my dad and about six or seven of the other men there, they would go up and cook the hog. And some of us boys, and you know, we're probably somewhere from the ages of 11 to about 13, maybe 10 to about 12, we'd get to go up with dads, and you know, they'd stay up all night and cook this pig, and we'd go up in the early evening and play in the lake, and then us boys would kind of camp out in the woods. You always had one or two of these boys who just couldn't leave his father alone, always going there going, hey, dad, 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 dad. The thing was, the men sat over there, cooked this pig, drank beer, they had a keg of beer, and we used to tell these boys going, look, just leave your dad alone, listen to him. Listen to the sound of his laughter. That was important. I'd hear my own dad laugh, and it was a laugh I didn't hear at home. It was a different laugh. It was like the laugh of an 18-year-old or something, you know, a man set free. Because it was just the men, so they'd cook all night long. They'd stay up all night cooking that pig, and us boys were discounted. We'd camp out in the woods there, just make some lean-tos, and just sort of camp out with our sleeping bags. In fact, we'd sneak up and get a little bit of beer out of those kegs. But, you know, different times in the 70s, different times. So morning would come and the guys were all up. The men would be up and they'd be chopping barbecue and get us boys down there to do the chopping. And so we'd get it chopped and the men would be tired. And about, you know, 9, 10 in the morning, all the moms and the ladies would start showing up with the casseroles and the slaw and the side dishes and the sweet tea. And the men were just kind of hungover and tired. And all I remember seeing are the cars out there on the road coming down to the lake, and like my dad would be laying in the back seat with the door open and his feet were just sticking out on the ground. And you look up there and you'd see all these men, you just see these legs out the back door, and they lay on that back seat and take a good 3-hour nap, get up. Boy, people would start coming, all the guests, you know, you got the sandwiches going, us boys would help serve. I liked making sandwiches for people. Everybody was in a good mood. My parents were in a fantastic mood. You know, the night before, I heard laughs out of my dad I'd never heard before. Just hearing those men, all those men sitting down there laughing and just having a good time and staying up all night cooking that pig and throwing that party for the people. I like to think there's two kind of people in the world. There's those that like to go to the party and those that like to throw the party. Well, me and my family, we like to throw the party. You get to visit with everybody. You set it up for people. And those sandwiches up there would be fantastic. I'd eat about 3. There'd be banana pudding, peach cobbler. There'd be chocolate mayonnaise cake. Just everything that you loved. Green beans. There'd be baked beans, potato salad, deviled eggs, watermelon, fresh cut up garden cantaloupe. It was fantastic. So that is why barbecue is so important to me as a cultural thing. And the older I get, the more it means to me emotionally. And to bring it over and serve it to all these kids tomorrow, even though we didn't get ribs when we were kids, you know, but Oliver wanted some butts for him and his friends, and they decided, you know, I'd do a pretty mean rib. You can't beat a rib. A rib will always go first, but the chopped pork sandwich is what really talks to me. And that's just kind of my barbecue story. So every time I cook it, I will eat your barbecue as quickly as I'll eat this, but this barbecue is the one that touches my heart, my soul, and eventually my gut. Barbecue, that porkish delight. I crave it morning, noon, and night. To eat it is a palate's delight. To serve it is downright polite. Barbecue. North Carolina style. Woo, buddy. Ooh, these boys are starting to look good in there. They're getting soft, but I'm gonna let them cook another 3 hours, maybe 4. Up till about midnight. Oh yeah. All right, time to put a little vinegar on that. And have a right taste of that.
Oh, man.
Well, it's getting close to midnight, and these butts are looking good. Now it's time to wrap them in foil, turn the cooker off, just have some fire going, let them just taper down while I lay over there in the hammock and take a nap. Oh my, look at this meat. Hitting that with a little vinegar. Man, that's got that fat in there. Whoa. All right, starting to get these ribs ready. Peeling. We're gonna peel that membrane, and I'll show you what that looks like. So what I do is I go up under the bone, that first little bone here, and I kinda cut that. And what there is there's a little bit of membrane. All right. Basically the fascia, and I grab it with a paper towel. You can see I'm peeling that back now. I use this paper towel mainly just to get a little grip on that. It's a little easier. I just peel that membrane right on off. Some racks peel easier than others. And get that out of there, and that, taking that off right there, that's what really
helps make a good rib.
Just ripped into that first butt, and the meat is like butter. Just pulling off the bone like that. Just falling apart. I can just reach in and just pull that right out.
We're gonna get to the chop. Now, this process will go on a while. Add a little sauce to it. Mix that in.
All right. Starting to get the butts chopped up, and got a lot of the ribs on there. Yeah, that meat is just falling off that butt. I just pull it right off that little shoulder bone, and it just comes out so easily. And here it is, chopped pork, the red slaw on the white bun. These days, I actually like a bread and butter pickle on mine. Put that baby together. I'm gonna wrap that up. Eat that tomorrow. Boom. Man, I have got a lot of ribs on here. Look at all them ribs. And they still ain't done. Still gotta keep them going. It's on the ribs. I rubbed them with a mix of Bad Byron's Bud Rub, Bad Byron's Bud Rub, for your ribs so good. And I mixed a little brown sugar in there with the Bad Byron's. Rub that on. Okay, I flipped them over for a while. Now I'm going to flip them back over. Let them go just a little bit more, but they're getting there. They are getting there. There goes my wife. Oh, I got the fan going. Man, we are coming to the end of this cook. This is the first time I've sat down all day long. It just feels good to sit in front of this fan. It was like 96 degrees. Then it kind of rained a little and got cloudy. It's cloudy now and dropped down to about 88. I ran down to the lake and I dove in, and that felt so good. Got me rejuvenated. Now I got the sauce on the ribs. Take a regular barbecue sauce and I just add a little honey to it. And on top of that brown sugar and everything, we got kind of a sweet, zesty rib. Hey, quit honking that horn. Trying to talk here to the people. Anywho, let this stuff caramelize a little bit, get them out, cut them up. Maybe let these go just a hair longer. That is the funniest and sweetest little thing I ever seen. Little turtle in a hammock. That just came in the mail. Oh yeah. It's the first rack I've cut up here. Look at that, man. A lot of top meat on that baby back. Woo, buddy! Well, I gotta keep on slicing. I got to keep on slicing. You didn't like that to end up on your table. Take them away, Mag.
So fun.
So fun. Right. Ribs, 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 pork, pork, ribs, ribs. And right over here, we got slaw, slaw. Think I got it all? 20 minutes till the party. Nobody's on time. We're going to show up, start serving that food immediately. But you know what? You do this kind of stuff for family.